What exactly is a server? This term can actually mean quite different things based on the context. And with this video, I hope I can give you a complete overview. But is this not super simple? Well, I like to make videos that I wish I had when I was younger. And when I was around 17 years old, I taught myself web development to make browser games, and I used web servers all the time. But I have this super weird, vivid memory of walking into a classroom contemplating about what is a server. I just couldn't grasp it, which means there are probably more like me that ask the same question. So this video is dedicated to my 17-year-old self and anybody else who struggles with this question. When you want to know something, Wikipedia is always a good place to start. But when looking at the Wikipedia overview page for server, let's actually ignore the computing category and instead we go down to the roles, where we can find the servers as in waiting staff in a restaurant. Servers are those who work at a restaurant, a diner or a bar, and sometimes in private homes, attending to customers by supplying them with food and drink as requested. And this is probably the best and only definition you need to know for server. You request something from a server and the server gives you what you requested. Video over. Though I know, this would not have been enough for me with 17. It still feels very abstract and I need something a bit more tangible. So let's start with something my 17-year-old did know, and those are game servers. Lots of the games we used to play back then are not as popular anymore. So let's look at Minecraft. You can play Minecraft locally or you can play on a server. Here, for example, is the download page for the official Minecraft server, and it's actually a jar file. So this is a program written in the programming language Java. And those instructions may look a bit complicated and confusing, but when you execute it, it's like any other program you execute. Look here in the task manager of Windows, showing all the running processes and programs. So this Minecraft server is a program like all the others. Discord, Photoshop, Notepad, all of them just programs. And this is the first lesson. Don't get confused by the word server and think that it's anything special or magical. The term server just describes the role or the purpose of what the program does. But it's just a program. All right, but what makes this program a server now? It supplies you with data you requested. On the surface, you play a game, but to make this game work, data is sent between your game client and the game server. And here's another important term, client. I guess there's no server without a client. So as a client or customer in a restaurant, if you want something, you ask the server for it and the server gives it to you. So in the case of a Minecraft client and server, your game client, which is by the way also just another program, it asks the server, for example, hey, I want to play here. I need some information. Can you please give me the world data? And the server sends you part of the world and also tells you, by the way, this is how much life you have and this is your position. Now, here the comparison to a restaurant staff falls a bit short, because in a client-server setup, you are not only asking the server for information, but it's expected you also supply information. For example, your current position or if you want to punch a tree. But in the end, client and server are just programs, and these terms just describe the role they have. Now, in this example, the client and server program are located on the same computer. Look, both of them are here in the task manager. So how do they communicate? Communication is an integral part for the client and server relationship. And most of the time, it's some kind of networking. In the case of Minecraft, they communicate with raw TCP packets using their own special Minecraft protocol. We can use tools like Wireshark to look at all the network packets being sent and received. And if we filter for the correct port, we can see here, even if it's on the same computer, they still use network packets with an IP and port. So whether the program is located on the same computer or located on another computer somewhere on the internet, it doesn't matter. Minecraft server and client just exchange TCP packets. Now, besides game servers, you maybe also have heard of web servers. And you can guess they are probably just a program as well. Exactly. Web servers are also just programs running on some computer. In this example here, I have a computer running the Linux operating system. And if we look at the list of running processes, we can see here Nginx. Nginx is a program implementing web server functionality, meaning You can use a client like a browser to request a document from the server, for example, the index.html file. And this communication is also using TCP networking, or more specifically using the HTTP protocol to send a request and receive a response from the server. So to summarize, when we use the word server, we might just talk about a program that fulfills a certain purpose. As you have seen with two examples, a web server and a Minecraft server, this purpose is always to give out information that a client requested. So the server can be seen as a program that is like the center of information, and a client or multiple clients can contact the server to get or exchange that information. And so this obviously applies to many more use cases. For example, a database server is just a program offering a database, which is just fancy data storage. An email server is just a software that can send and receive emails for you, which you can connect to with an email client. Pretty straightforward. Now, besides server in the software context, sometimes we use the word server in other situations. Actually, let me replay a sentence from the previous section. In this example here, I have a computer running the Linux operating system, and if we look at the list of running processes, we can see here Nginx. Okay, but actually in the first version of the script, I wanted to say this. In this example here, I have a Linux server, and if we look at the list of running processes, we can see here Nginx. As you can see, I changed the wording because there I was talking about server in the context of software, and it's probably too confusing suddenly using the word server in a different context. So now let's talk about this other use. Here, when I say Linux server, I simply mean a computer system. It's just a computer running the Linux operating system. But there's a reason why I don't just say here is a Linux system versus here's a Linux server. And that is because this is a rented machine on the internet. With services like Amazon's AWS, DigitalOcean, Google Cloud, or whatever service you use, you can rent computers. It is even built hourly sometimes. As you can see, I can configure a computer I want with whatever CPU, RAM, and disk space, and then I can just rent it. To access it, I need some remote access tool, usually SSH, Secure Shell, which you can use to remotely log into this other computer and then use it like any other computer, meaning you can run any program you like on there. But the reason why we usually don't just generically call it a computer and call it a server is because they are mostly used to run server software, like a Minecraft server. Does that make sense? Maybe another example would help. So this is a phone and this is a Nintendo Switch gaming console. Both are computers, but we call them phone and gaming console. We call them that because that's their primary purpose. The phone can also run arbitrary apps, even games, but the primary focus is phone services. Actually, that's not true anymore, right? Who uses a smartphone as a telephone nowadays? Anyway, what about this computer? It's a computer, but you mainly play games on it. So the purpose is a gaming console, and that's why we call it like that. So you get the point. I call my rented Linux computer a server because that's the intended purpose. Even if I run a program like FFmpeg to convert a video file or something, this is not a server program. But I would still call this computer a Linux server, just how I call this a phone. That's the primary use case. Okay, all of those explanations kind of make sense. But I know when I was 17, it would still feel a bit abstract. People always said that these servers you can rent, they are just computers. But when I saw these data center pictures, they didn't look like my laptop. They really confused me. And to really understand it, it actually took a few more years because eventually I went to university and there, for the first time, I walked into a data center and saw one of those servers for real. But more importantly, I had to open them up and install some RAM and plug in a PCIe device. And that's when it really clicked. I cannot share this magical moment with you easily, but actually you have it much better. I'm so jealous that YouTube didn't really exist back then, or it just didn't know these kind of channels, because nowadays you can just go to channels like Linus Tech Tips where you can actually see how these data center computers or servers look like, how they are built, and you can see they just have a motherboard, a CPU, RAM, maybe a graphics card, power supply. They are just like your damn regular computer, just a different form factor. And you could also buy them online. I don't know if I was just an idiot, but yeah, for me, really seeing this made me understand. That's what a server in a data center looks like. It really is just a computer. And again, we just call them servers because their main purpose is to run some kind of server software on it. So you can see the purpose server is really the important part. If something acts like a server, we call it a server. And I know this is a super beginner type video, but I owe it to my 17-year-old me. But we can also try to get a bit more technical now. Let's go into a bit of programming. What exactly is server software? I mentioned earlier that communication is an integral part of a server. Somehow a client has to be able to talk to a server. How this communication is done could really be anything. It could be basic networking like raw TCP packets. When you have programming in school like Java programming, a very common exercise is also to implement a server and client using sockets. I know sockets is another confusing term, but sockets is just the name for a functionality offered by the operating system, and it's a function allowing you to listen for connections or establish connections to another server. So using those sockets, you can implement a server like a web server. Let me show you. Here, for example, is a simple web server implemented in Python. So this is just a Python program using the Flask module to create a web server. As you can see, I don't use sockets here myself because the library actually does this for me. I show it to you. So the program is now listening on port 5000 and we can use a browser as a client to connect to it. It works. We see a website. Now let's use a tool called strace to look at all the system calls, so operating system functions used by the Python program. And here we can see it uses sockets to listen for incoming connections. And this is important to understand. You have the operating system feature called socket, which you can use to listen for connections. And on the other side, you have the functionality you implement with that. So socket is the technical feature and a server describes the purpose or behavior you actually implement with that. Which means you could make use of other technical features and still implement the behavior of a server. But what could that be? Let me show you an example. Here is the Mozilla VPN app. This is not an ad, don't get a VPN, I don't even have an account here. It's just a random VPN app I downloaded and installed because I want to show you something. Every VPN software has multiple parts. You have the UI, and you might think clicking on a button just launches maybe OpenVPN to establish a VPN connection, but configuring the network on a system to establish a VPN usually requires root permissions, and the app is not running as root. So most VPNs have an unprivileged process with your fancy UI, and additionally, they run a second process as root to actually then launch the VPN to configure the network and so forth. In this case, the Mozilla VPN daemon. So how do the interface and the root process communicate? Well, server and client. The Mozilla daemon in this case is the server, and the regular user process is the client, and they communicate using so-called Unix domain sockets. As a programmer, it feels very similar to regular socket programming. You just create a socket and send data back and forth, but there is no traditional networking with IPs and ports. There's actually a socket file. Everything in Linux is a file, it's a meme, so it's not really a file, it's a Unix domain socket. This enables inter-process communication, IPC. I know these terms are even more confusing, but point being, this is not a regular TCP network connection. The UI being the client uses the file or Unix domain socket or inter-process communication as a way to communicate to the server, the root daemon. So yes, this is actually a server and this is a client. To summarize, the technology is Unix domain sockets, the purpose and role implemented is server and client. I hope now you understand server just describes a certain behavior, and that's why it's useful as a term when we talk with each other to convey that behavior. But so far we looked at the term server somewhat in isolation, and I want to bring it back into a bit of a wider context because there are other terms that are synonyms or describe something very similar. And I believe looking at some of these other terms can be important to better understand everything. And there's one in particular I want to talk about, and that is master and slave. It describes a behavior where one component controls another component. For obvious reasons, the term is outdated. But the problem is lots of technology and source code still uses those terms, so it's still important to know about. But in many places, alternative names are now used, and they often can fit much better anyway, like controller and target, primary and secondary, provider and consumer. In the end, all those terms are just used to describe a certain role and behavior of a system to other people. And so whatever term is used, as you can see, it kind of looks like server and client as well, right? And the reason why I wanted to talk about this setup, so the setup where one component controls the other component, is because this can be described as server and client as well. But here's the interesting question. What is the server here? It depends. By the definition I mentioned earlier for a server, the server is the component that acts upon request and responds to what was requested. So in such a setup, all of those are probably servers. The controller here requests the targets to do something and they respond back, yes, I did it. However, oftentimes how this is actually implemented is that the controller opens a socket and waits for clients to connect to it. Maybe it's even a web server. It could be that they even ask the controller, do you have work for me? So they send the request and then the controller responds to that request. So is now the controller the server after all? So really both could be called server and client. It really depends what you want to convey, what context and layer we are talking about. In my opinion, it's really not clear. Do you want to call this the server and those the clients because this one is listening on a port? Maybe it's a web server and the clients connect to it, asking for work and sending back the result. Or do you want to call this the client and those the servers because in the end, the controller requests results and data from the targets? Both is right, both is wrong. Maybe even the documentation calls this client and those servers because it makes sense. The controlling unit requests data from those servers. But in the actual underlying code, you call this the server and those the clients because those clients connect to the listening server. It's confusing, I know, but this is how language works. The terms mean something, but depending on the context, it could mean something differently. In the end, we just make up words that hopefully help to communicate to others what we mean, and these meanings can also change over time. Technology gets more complicated, it's all fuzzy. So don't get too hung up on what is the perfect definition. In the end, we just try to communicate some behavior or role of a system, and we hope it helps other people to understand what it does. I hope this video about what is a server was somewhat interesting. At least I think my 17-year-old self would have been happy about this explanation, but let me know what you think about this format. Is this interesting to do more often? Are there maybe other computer science terms that you find difficult to grasp? Or maybe are you a teacher at a school and you know about concepts your students struggle with? Or was this video a waste of time? Let me know in the comments below. Thanks.